This is the face of the first man in recorded history who believed in one god. Akhenaten was the great rebel. He broke with the traditional religion of many gods and became the first monotheist. There was but one god, Aten, the sun. Aten was a gentle god. His beneficent rays end in life-giving hands. There was revolution in the arts as well. The wall paintings of Akhenaten's palace portray a new kind of realism. These new techniques also found expression in ceramics. The carnelian ring bears an unflattering likeness of the king, for he insisted on stark realism in the portrayal of his own person, even though the results were rather grotesque. Breaking sharply with the idealistic portrayal of Egypt's god king. Akhenaten and his queen, Nefertiti. It was their dream that Egypt would follow their ideals, but the world was not yet ready. Nefertiti, a beautiful one has come. But under this idealistic leadership, the neglected empire was crumbling. Revenues dwindled. When Akhenaten died, the cult of Aten died with him, and Egypt reverted to the worship of its multiple gods. By the time of the 18th dynasty, tombs had been despoiled to an alarming extent. The kings no longer desired to be buried in a conspicuous place. Beyond the cliffs which flanked the Theban necropolis lay a wilderness of desert hills. Deep in the valley of the tombs of the kings, they hoped to remain undisturbed throughout eternity. But this was not to be. Of all the pharaohs buried here, only one name is generally known today. Ironically, the young and unimportant king, Tutankhamen, was the only ruler of this period whose tomb was not plundered in ancient times. King Tut was only 19 when he died. A later and more powerful king was buried just above Tutankhamen. Debris covered the tomb entrance so effectively that it lay hidden for over 3,000 years. While every other tomb was desecrated, the young King Tut lay undisturbed among an enormous quantity of funerary equipment, designed to sustain him in the afterworld with all the pomp and panoply of Pharaoh's court. For an Egyptian monarch ruled as a god king in life and was worshipped as a deity when he died. An ivory fan bears the royal cartouche. In addition to its powerful deities, Egypt had a host of household gods, such as the god Bes, whose function belied his fierceness. Appealing to the vanity of the ladies, his realm included the overlordship of cosmetics. The back of Tutankhamen's golden throne shows the king and queen in an informal domestic scene. A golden dagger and sheath, prototype of blades familiar throughout history. the inner coffin of solid gold, lavishly covered with chaste design and inlaid with semi-precious stones, contained the mummy of Tutankhamun. The magnificence of these trappings of a minor king leads us to wonder what must once have lain in the resting places of the great conquerors and statesmen. As a result of the political and religious tensions created by the Aten Revolution, the power of the ruling house was undermined. The 18th dynasty ended in political and social decay, and a neglected empire lay in ruins. Just at this time, when the new kingdom seemed doomed, the general Horemheb came to the fore. This astute politician had managed to remain in favor in a period of conflicting factions and ideas. He cleverly maneuvered himself onto the throne. Pharaoh Horemheb, the strong man, saved Egypt from certain ruin. His social reforms strengthened the home economy, and his campaigns restored much of the former empire. Horemheb fully restored the power of the traditional religion of Amun, with its worship of multiple gods. The mythological trinity of Egypt is built around Osiris, Isis, and Horus. Osiris was a legendary king who was destroyed by a treacherous brother. He was raised up again with the help of his devoted wife, Isis, and avenged by their son, Horus. Anubis, the jackal, was in charge of the funeral rites and the guide of the dead in the hereafter. The walls and ceilings of the tombs of the kings were lavishly adorned with religious symbols and figures. Stylized stars decorated the ceilings of some of the tombs. Leads to the great temple of Amun at Karnak, the most extensive ever built by man. This complex of pylons, obelisks, courts, halls, and inner chambers was 2,000 years in construction. Succeeding monarchs from the Middle Kingdom to the dawn of the Christian era here enshrined their beliefs and accomplishments. Standing in the midst of these mighty works is the forest of columns called the Hypostyle Hall. The papyrus and lotus represent the union of Upper and Lower Egypt. Colossal red granite scarab overlooks the sacred lake. The Temple of Karnak, majestic even in ruins, bears silent witness to the faith and skill of those who labor to raise it. While the royal tombs are concerned with religion and the gods, the tombs of the nobles depict with realism the life of the times. It is these lowly tillers of the soil who carried the load of empire. In the fields of a huge estate, the harvest is in progress. Wheat is cut with a scythe, transported on a pole, threshed under the hooves of the oxen, and cleaned by winnowing. In the afterworld, the throwing stick brings down foul on the wing. In this happy hunting ground, game is abundant and the waters well stocked. The noble lord and his lady, who certainly never did so in life, plow the heavenly fields and harvest the wheat and pull the flax. The superb color values remaining in these paintings, over 3,000 years old, are a credit to the technical knowledge of the artist. While Anubis administers to the deceased, the professional mourners prove their grief.